to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
Therefore, let him who thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. Welcome to our study of the book of 1 Corinthians. Chapters 9 and 10, Paul is going to deal with the need to examine oneself, the need to look inside your own life to make sure that you're really living as God wants you to. Paul first looks to his own life as a gospel preacher and as a Christian to make sure he's living right himself, and then he draws up an Old Testament example of Israel during the wanderings to show that if a child of God is not careful, he can fall away and be lost. Friend, the idea that once I become a Christian, I can never be lost is foreign to the teaching of the Bible. And Paul shows us this in this text. In chapter 9, Paul is going to defend his own right to be a gospel preacher and to be paid in some ways. He begins the first section of 1 Corinthians 9 by showing he has that right. The worker is worthy of his wages. Paul says we've got a right to be paid. We've got a right as we do the work of the Lord to be provided for by the brethren. Now, I want you to notice especially 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and look at, or 1 Corinthians 9, and notice what Paul says in verse 14. Here's Paul's words. He says, "Even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel." If a man dedicates his life to preaching the word, the gospel, going around teaching the lost, communicating the word of God to the brethren, encouraging the saints, Jesus said he has a right to live by the gospel, implying that he has a right to be paid. Now, Paul said the Lord said this. Well, where did the Lord say this? Well, if we look in Luke chapter 10, verse 7, the Lord did teach exactly that. Notice what Jesus Himself said. Jesus said, "And remain in the same house, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his wages." Quote from Deuteronomy chapter 25 and verse 4. "You shall not muzzle the ox while he treads out the grain." There's an image. You've got an ox working in the field, and you wouldn't put a muzzle on his mouth so while he's working he couldn't eat, would you? Well, no one would do that. You would allow him to do that as he works. Now, Jesus uses this illustration, the worker is worthy of his hire, to show that someone who is truly working in the kingdom is worthy of being paid by those who give to the gospel cause on the first day of the week. Now, think about the words of Galatians 6, verse 6. Paul says, "Let him who has been taught the gospel share in all good things with him who teaches the gospel." Christians have the right, the responsibility, nay, to share with gospel teachers those things that they need to survive in this life. And so may we understand, first and foremost, Paul examines his own life to make sure he is working for the cause of Christ, and he lets the brethren know, "I'm doing the work of God. You have a right to pay me from the gospel." But then Paul also identifies another right that he as a gospel preacher has, and that is to be married. In 1 Corinthians 9, verses 5 and 6, Paul identifies the fact that they had the right to carry along a believing wife just as some of the others had done. Friend, you never see in the Bible where preachers have to live a celibate life, that they cannot marry, that they have to remain single all their days and be away from all the cares of the world. That's not what the Bible teaches. Not the things that God has ordained to be holy, like marriage. You see, my friends, in the New Testament, when we see gospel preachers, they did have wives, some of them. Think about Peter. 1 Peter 5, we know Peter was a gospel preacher, but we also know he was an elder. Now, what's the qualification of an elder? 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1, they must have a wife and children. In Matthew 8, verse 14, we know that Peter did have a wife, for Jesus came and healed Peter's mother-in-law. And so, yes, Paul had a right to preach the gospel and be paid by that. He had a right to have a wife, to have some of the things God has ordained as holy. But friends, although Paul had this right, Paul also is going to say in this chapter, he did not have to be paid. Yes, it was a right. Yes, it was something he could do, but he didn't always insist on doing that. Paul's going to say at times, I chose not to be paid so that it would not become a stumbling block to some who didn't understand this teaching. And so while it was a right, it was not something Paul had to do. Now, as Paul examines himself, one of the things he sets before us in 1 Corinthians 9 is that we must make sure, just as Paul was making sure, we've got to make sure that we're running the race of Christianity faithfully and that we've got the mindset of winning that race. I want you to notice what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 24. What a marvelous text this is. Look at the words of verse 24. Paul says, "Do you not know that those who run in a race all run?" Everybody who gets in a race runs. That's his point. But one receives the prize. Now notice this. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Christianity is likened unto a race. My friends, we are enduring, running faithfully every day, following Jesus. That's the idea of the race. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, the Bible says, "Seeing then that we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith." Paul likens Christianity to a race in 2 Timothy chapter 2, where he says we've got to compete according to the rules. And so we look to Jesus, we compete according to the rules, we run with endurance. But my friends, we've also got to run with the mindset of winning. Would you enter a race if you didn't think you could win? Well, some people might, but it wouldn't make much sense to enter a competition of any kind if at least you didn't have the hope, the desire of wanting to win that. My friends, that's the idea of Christianity. So many people get into Christianity because it's a good social thing to do. It makes them feel better. Why should we be in Christianity? Well, to serve God, no doubt. But we enter the Christian race with one goal in mind, and that is to win. Look at what Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Verses 6 through 8. Here's Paul's mindset about the Christian race. Paul says, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord will give to me, but not to me only, but all those who have loved His appearing." Paul said, I've finished the race. I've received the crown of life. I'm ready to gain that. Paul wasn't in it just to be in it. Paul was in it to win. And friend, unless you're in Christianity to win the battle, to receive the prize, Philippians 3, verses 12 through 14, to make it to heaven, then my friend, you'll never get there. You have to have a goal in mind if you're going to achieve what you want in this life. And so Paul says, in essence, you've got to run the Christian race with the prize in mind. Notice what he says in verse 25 of this same chapter. Paul says, "And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate or self-controlled in all things." He says, "Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown," but notice this, "but we an imperishable crown." What is the prize of Christianity? Am I going to receive a victor's crown? Am I going to receive a victor's wreath like they did in the first century? Am I going to receive a certain allotment of money or some kind of jewelry or something of value today? No, that's not what's being spoken of. All those things corrupt and perish with using. Paul says we've got to run with an imperishable crown in mind. What are we talking about? Jesus said, "Be faithful unto death, and I'll give you the crown of life," Revelation 2, verse 10. Paul said in Romans 8, verse 18, "We consider the sufferings of this world, they're not even worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Jesus Himself said in Matthew 25, verse 46, "The righteous would go away into eternal life." Hebrews 4, verse 9 says, "There remains therefore a rest for the people of God, a place where there be no more sin, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more death." Revelation 21, verses 3 and 4, "A place where we'll be in the presence of God forever." That's the prize we have. And that's the endurance that we are. That's what gives us our endurance. And so as we strive to look within ourselves, let's remind ourselves, we're running a race. We need to run to win. And my friends, we've got the greatest prize you can ever imagine in mind, heaven itself. Therefore, Paul's going to say in verse 27, we need to be trained with discipline. We've got to, just like a runner who has to get up and run even when it hurts, just like a bodybuilder who pushes his muscles to the extent that they burn, so Christians must train themselves like that with self-discipline. Notice Paul's words in verse 27. What a powerful statement this is. Paul says, "But I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become a castaway. I beat," some versions say, "I discipline." That is the idea of I train my body, I bring it into subjection, lest when I preach to others, when I go out and tell other people don't live in sin, and I go out and do it, I'm a castaway. My friend, running the Christian race means that we have to train ourselves every day. You can't just get up and say, "Well, I think I'll run the Christian race today." My friend, you've got to be preparing every day to run that race. Paul said, "I beat, I discipline my body." My friends, if we're going to win the Christian race, we've got to discipline ourselves daily. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12, Paul said, "I'll not be brought under the power of any." The only thing we allow to control our minds and our lives is the teaching of Jesus. Anything that gets in the way, that pulls us off the track, is causing us to lose sight of the race. And so Paul says, "I discipline my body, I bring it into subjection." Friend, if we're going to win the race, we've got to control the body. How does that runner, as he approaches the last 2 or 3 miles of a long race, how is it that he keeps pushing himself even though every muscle and every fiber is crying out to quit? He's got the goal in mind. He has trained himself. He has promised he's going to endure to the end. He's going to cross that line. He's not going to give up. Remember Matthew 6:33, "We seek first the kingdom. We're faithful unto death." Revelation 2 verse 10, "We never ever give up. We look to Jesus." There's the goal. And so we must train with self-discipline, or like someone who stands up and says something then goes out and lives another way, we're disqualified from the race. Now in chapter 10, Paul is going to remind us of an example of some people who did become disqualified. He says, "Now you've got to make sure you don't become disqualified. Here's an example of some of God's own children who did." In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he's going to draw up the example of the people who came out of Egyptian bondage. You remember the setting. In the book of Exodus, a new Pharaoh arose who did not know Joseph. As a result, he began to be a hard taskmaster, making the people work hard. He was very evil toward killing some of those people. As a result, they were in great oppression, so they cry out to God. God sends a deliverer, Moses. He delivers them through the plagues. And at the end, God opens up the Red Sea. They cross through on dry land. The Egyptians are killed in that sea. But what happened to those people after they crossed through the Red Sea? Do you remember? They began to complain. They began to murmur. And it's amazing that they even said this, but they did. You read Exodus 15, 16, and 17, and the people said this, "Oh, how we wish we were back by the flesh pots in Israel. You've brought us out here to kill us." These people who cried out to God for deliverance are now blaming God for delivering them and saying He's going to kill them. You see, that example teaches us that we've got to be careful lest we become fickle, lest we complain, and lest we want to give up on the journey. Now, these Old Testament people, we know a little bit about them. 1 Corinthians 10, 1 and 2 teaches us, as well as the book of Exodus, that these people were baptized into Moses. Now, here's the setting, and Paul sets this up to show Christians they're a lot like you. Look in chapter 10, verses 1 and 2. Paul says, "Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and the sea." And so here you've got a type of baptism like the Christian baptism. They were baptized into Moses. Christians are baptized into Christ. Well, look at the form of baptism. They went through the Red Sea, wall on both sides, moisture under them, moisture on top. You've got the cloud. They were surrounded by water. There's the picture of immersion, just like the Christian baptism. They were baptized into Moses. We're baptized into Christ. Now, just like these people, so today Christians have spiritual food and spiritual drink, and that is the teachings of Christ. Jesus said in John chapter 6, "I am the living bread. I am the water of life. You come to me, you'll never thirst, you'll never hunger." Well, in verse 3, we learn that Jesus, the rock that followed them, or the cloud and the rock, He was that spiritual food and spiritual drink that they had also. And so He's showing them that these people are a lot like you. They were baptized. They found sustenance in Christ, although they themselves may not have known that. And notice what He says about these same people. He's going to say, these people serving as an example to us of how we must not do certain things or we'll be lost. Well, what did they do? We learn from verse 6. They lusted after evil things. My friends, these people were a very lustful people. They had physical lust and passions and desires, and the evil things of the people around them they allowed to cause them to be a part of. Their desires were so strong that they left God, quit running the race, and got involved in sin. Friends, we can do the same thing today if we're not careful. How many people are going to be lost today because they let a fleshly lust lead them off the path of righteousness? Here's what Peter says in 1 Peter 2, verse 11. Abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul. I've got to realize that my flesh is not what leads me. My passions, my desires, my wants in this life cannot control me. John said, all that is in the world, lust of flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not of the Father, but of the evil one. And he who does that, he's going to pass away and be lost. What else did these people do? They became idolaters. Verse 7, they got involved in idolatry like some of the nations around them. They started worshiping false gods and looking up to false gods. You remember the account, Exodus chapter 20. Moses is up receiving the Ten Commandments. A little later, he stays up there too long. The people began to think, and so they decide to make themselves a god. Aaron takes up their gold. In essence, they say, well, we threw it in the fire and it just jumped out. They made themselves an image and began to worship it as God. Now, someone says, well, I'm not going to do that. And Christians, you're surely not doing that today. Can we not, though, become idolaters? Anything, listen carefully, anything in your life that takes first place over God becomes your idol. That's why John warned in 1 John chapter 5, toward the end of the chapter, little children, beware. Make sure that we don't get involved in idolatry. He's not talking about worshiping other gods necessarily. That would be implied as well. But the idea is that anything, whether it be the almighty dollar, whether it be our job, whether it be our family, whether it be some hobby I have, anything that comes before Christ takes first place in my life can become my idol. He then warns them, like the people there, you must make sure you don't get involved in sexual immorality. Some of these people got involved in sexual immorality, and a great multitude of them died because of it. There were immoral people during that time. Immoral sexual people, the religions around them, the beliefs of people in the nations around them was that you need to practice sexual immorality as a way to worship some of these deities we have. They got involved in that. They had problems inside the camp. Friends, we need to be careful today, lest because of sexual immorality we are caused to leave Christ. Hebrews 13:4 says this, marriage is honorable and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers, God says, I will judge. You cannot live in fornication, live in adultery, be caught or found or be practicing immoral sexual acts and think you're going to be okay. God, even if nobody else knows, God knows. Hebrews 4 verse 13 says, all things are open and naked before the eyes of Him with whom we must give an account. Paul said to those in Corinth, such were some of you, sexually immoral, sodomites, homosexuals, fornicators, such were some of you, but you were washed. When I become a Christian, I obey the gospel, I've got to turn away from that. If not, I can be lost. Now, what else did these people do? They tempted Christ and they complained. My friend, when we don't trust God, when we put ourselves in places of authority where we don't belong, as some of them did, when we defy the will of God and we begin to complain, then we leave the straight and narrow path. Someone says, I can't believe these people complain. Look at all that God did. They saw the plagues. They saw the Nile turn to blood. They saw the Red Sea open up and walk through on dry ground. How could they complain? Exodus chapter 16 and 17 teaches us they did exactly that. They complained and murmured, and because of that they wandered for 40 years until everyone 20 years or above perished at that time. Someone says, how could they do that? How can we do that? How can we today complain also when we have so much more than they did? Hebrews chapter 2 teaches us that we cannot neglect the great salvation which we have now, which they did not have. We have the full mystery revealed. We have all the knowledge of God that we need. God's plan of salvation is sending His Son has come down to us. How can we complain? But Paul says in Philippians 2 verses 14 and 15, Complaining and murmuring is not something God wants us to do. We're to make sure that we don't complain and murmur against God and His ways. We need to learn this. We need to learn, as Paul did in Philippians 3, to be content in whatever state we're in. These people, my friends, serve as our examples, and here's the way they serve that. I want you to notice 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 12. In verse 11, he's going to say, now these people are your examples, as Romans 15, 4 teaches. Things were written aforetime, were written for our learning. Well, what are these people an example of? Notice verse 12. Paul says, therefore, since all these things happened to God's people who were baptized into Moses, who had sustenance found in Jesus, who were provided for by God, since all these things happened to them, look how they represent not only God's people then, but in a picture, you in some ways. He says, look what can happen. They're an example of this, how that if we're not careful, as God's children, we can be lost and go to hell. Notice verse 12. Paul says, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. Friend, the idea and the teaching of some today that a child of God can never be lost is a damnable doctrine that's going to lead people to hell. This chapter overwhelmingly shows that God's children in the Old Testament violated His will. They got involved in sin and they were lost. They were destroyed by the destroyer, the text says. Now, my friends, if that happened to them, and we've got to give the more earnest heed lest we fall away, Hebrews 2 verses 1 through 4, how could anyone ever say a child of God can never be lost? The Bible overwhelmingly says they can. Galatians 5 verse 4, Paul said, you who are trying to attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. You've become severed from Christ. We say, religious world says, you can't fall from grace. You know what God said? Christians already had fallen from grace in the first century. They'd become cut off from Christ. Acts chapter 8, verses 20 through 22, Simon obeys the gospel. He sees that by the laying on of the apostles' hands, the gift of miracles is given. He could pass that on. He sees dollar signs in his mind, probably, and so he tries to buy that gift. And Peter said, your heart's not right with God. Your money, listen now, perish with you. What was going to perish? Simon was going to be lost. Revelation 3 verses 4 and 5, Jesus said that some would have their names written out of the book of life if they are taken out of the book of life if they weren't careful. And friends, if there's ever a text that teaches a son or a daughter of God can be lost, it's Luke 15. Think about the prodigal son. He was the son of the father. The father represents God. The son represents one of his children, likely Israel. That son went away into a far land, squandered his livelihood, was down in the mire and the muck with the pigs, and until he decided to come back, he was lost in that state, although he was a child of God. My friends, it's true and it's correct that we can be lost, but God doesn't want us to. And that's why we have 1 Corinthians 10, I believe verse 13. Is temptation going to arise? Are there going to be struggles? Is the lust of the flesh sometimes going to feel very powerful? Sure it is. But look at verse 13. Here's the help we have. God doesn't want us to be lost. Notice what Paul says. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Now, friends, temptation is true. It's something we all have to face. We're tempted. Jesus was tempted. Matthew chapter 4. But no temptation, realize this and understand this, I believe will help you 100%. Understanding that no temptation has occurred except such as common to other people. I'm not the only one who suffered that. And realizing that God, the faithful God, will give us the way of escape, my friends, gives me great strength. I'm not the only one who's ever suffered this, and God makes it possible for me to deal with that suffering. Well, how does He make it possible? Hebrews 4 verse 15, by the example of Jesus. He was tempted in all points as we are. Hebrews 2 verse 17 says, God gives us aid and help in time of need. How? By prayer. 1 Peter 5 verse 7, we can cast all our cares upon Him. By again, the example of Christ. 1 Peter 2 verse 21, by the all-powerful Word of God. Hebrews 4 verse 12, by the encouragement and fellowship of other Christians. My friends, God has given us everything we need to overcome temptation. There's no reason for us to be like those people and be lost. We can deal with it. But here's one of the ways we can do that. I believe verse 31 sets up the stage for how a Christian can make sure that he doesn't fall into sin and get lost, that he does endure temptation. Notice what Paul says in verse 31. Look at these beautiful words. Therefore, whether you eat or whether you drink, do all to the glory of God. How can I take heed to myself lest I fall? Do everything in your life with one mindset, with one overarching umbrella above everything you do. I want to glorify God with my life. Friend, if your life's goal is to glorify God, you're going to have so much an easier path to walk in this life. I'm not worried about self. Jesus said in Luke 9:23, you've got to deny yourself. I'm not living for the lust of flesh. I'm living for the Lord. Realize your purpose in being on this earth is to glorify God. Isaiah 43 verse 7, God said, everyone who's called by my name, whom I created for my glory, I've formed him, yes, I've made him. Why was I made? Why were you made? Why are we here on this earth? I'm here to glorify God. Ecclesiastes 12, verses 13 and 14 is a powerful passage that teaches us the purpose in life. What's life all about? Let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. What is? To fear God, to reverence Him, and keep His commandments. Why? God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. We need to make sure our goal is to seek first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6 and verse 33. Friend, as we think about examining our own life, we ask you today, won't you examine your life? Won't you look inside yourself and make sure, first of all, that you are a child of God? Are you a Christian? If not, you can become one today by obeying the gospel. Do you believe that Jesus is God's Son? John 8 verse 24. Are you willing to repent of sin? Luke chapter 13 verse 3. Would you confess the Savior, Jesus Christ, as the Son of God and Savior? Matthew 10 verse 32 and 33. And won't you do what Jesus said? He that believes and is baptized will be saved. Mark chapter 16 verse 16. Acts 2 verse 38. But maybe as a child of God, you know that you're not on the straight and narrow path. How thankful to God you ought to be. You've been afforded another opportunity to make it right. You need to repent before it's everlastingly late. Luke chapter 13, verses 3 and 5. And may each one of us do as Paul did and do as he encouraged Christians. Therefore, let him who thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wallet.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
And to God be the glory, and to God be the glory. This is the gospel of Christ.